Radiance ban. Hello to the two fans and welcome. This is Chicago Ted coming to you with the Hitbox Elite League. That is right. We are going to be bringing you some amazing European Dota this morning. Of course, it is Christmas Eve. I am not going to be standing this one out alone. I am being joined by Mr. Turbo. How you doing, man?
Pretty good. Excited to see these teams in action. See who comes out on top. It's a best of three, and we've already got underway into the draft. Invoker banned first. I've been seeing a lot of pros online saying that this hero is OP is everything. I think it was even Fogged saying that you could play him as a support now. You get Wex first and then zone out the enemy offlaner. I'm not too sure about that, but definitely worthy of a ban regardless.
10 seconds. Yeah, it's a hero that I think we talked about it in the pre-tournament show that we hosted on. I gotta say it was either Tuesday. Yeah, probably Tuesday, where we had one of the pros, Mr. Notahax, come in, and he was talking about the Invoker, and he's like, "Yeah, this is gonna be one of those heroes which will come in and become unstoppable in the next couple of weeks because people will get more familiar with playing him, and he just becomes a more, I don't know, versatile hero." This is anecdotal evidence, but I played against one yesterday, and holy hell, it was the hardest game of my life. Invoker does not take a lot to become very strong, and once he does become strong, he's very difficult to deal with. So, of course, being banned out, I haven't seen Avenge or an Oracle yet. This is surprising, but of course, Avenge carry could still be the thing. Pro Dota, they go with a Dazzle, which might be the indicator that they are going to grab that Venge, you know, to stack up the minus armor, or they could go for some basic, you know, back to the last patch and pick up a Slardar. But right now, Arcade, they do not fail to grab the Queen of Pain. They pick themselves up one of the most nightmarish supports at the moment, the Bane, and nightmarish, no pun intended.
No, you definitely intended that.
I wouldn't
mind seeing Venge picked up here by ProDotA. They definitely need a carry who can be active early. They need stuns too to deal with the quap. Although Venge isn't ideal because it flies in the air and it's easily disjointable if the quap is paying attention and has blink off cooldown. But just the early game presence that she gives you, where like you can farm in lane for 10-15 minutes and then start taking objectives and fights with your team, similar to a Gyrocopter, although he's been banned out. And she just helps your team so much. She has high armor, high HP at low levels. It's just difficult to gank. I would not mind that pick here at all, but we'll see what ProDotA decide to go for.
Yeah, they will grab the Vengeance Spirit. See, I know these teams now, dude. Like, I'm actually surprised we haven't seen an Oracle yet. That's honestly my opinion, given how he was played yesterday. But maybe looking back, he wasn't picked up as much as I might remember. Maybe I've got a little bit of nostalgia for yesterday. Whatever the case, for that one game, the Vengeful Spirit will be grabbed by ProDotA and most likely played as a carry role. And I mean, this seems to be the thing to do nowadays. And I'm not gonna bash it at all. It is very powerful, as you said. She offers so much, and even though, yeah, the stun's pretty easily disjointable by the Queen of Pain, perhaps by a good Bane player, the Nightmare, of course, giving you that little bit of invulnerability, it still is very hard to deal with the amount of damage she can deal physically, as well as the fact that Nether Swap is an incredible spell for early game ganking, for mid game team fights. It really does not have any shortage of usefulness. So the Venge, the Dazzle will combine to make a monster physical damage dealing duo, and we'll see what they go for the next couple of picks, but I imagine they might just build off of this physical DPS sort of style they've got going on. Maybe grab one more hard stunner either in the form of a mid or another support.
I like these bans from both teams too. Both correctly assessing that maybe this is going to be heavy early game focus for each side, so the Lone Druid would do well against Venge, I think, because she's not particularly good at fighting into the bear or, like, stopping pushes. She does have the debuff with her Wave of Terror and can pull creep waves off the tire, but besides that, she's not particularly good at anti-push. So anything that gets rid of her potential to fight early is a good ban, and I would say that bans from Arcade are also similarly good. The Viper just wins his mid lane against pretty much anybody. And the Slard are just enhancing that physical DPS. And of course, because they're on the dire side, it's important that you limit their potential to do Roche. So if they have a Dazzle and Eventual Spirit, you want to deny them that Slardar so they can't just take a easy Roche at like 12 minutes. Juggernaut.
I like the pick and I hate it. I love playing Juggernaut nowadays because he's like playing hard mode. No. I don't know. I don't know what the feel. I don't know what to feel about Juggernaut yet. I don't think I've seen him be played by pros, so I don't know. I'm just giving anecdotal evidence with some of the heroes I haven't seen yet. But
the stat stock that the lovely Lurkerderp put together for us, thank you, says that he is 3 wins out of 12 games, so 25% win percentage in this patch so far.
Oh, God.
Not a whole lot of sample size to go on, but
yeah.
He has not been great this patch, so we'll see if Arcade can pull it off. I'd still say that if you have a really good Juggernaut player who like sees it as a comfort pick,
yep,
then sometimes it's the best route to go for. But yeah, they do need something that can fight early against Venge. Juggernaut's kind of like, you can build him that way. You can just build him to fight early with like a drums or something and just bring the fight to the Venge. But they get more lockdown with the Beastmaster. I like this. It's an
I really like this. Beastmaster has got to be one of my favorite physical heavy offlaners or solo laners, whatever that you want to run him as. He can deal so much damage in so little time, and the inner beast that he's got going for him, that will make Venge and himself and any other person you pick on this team the hardest right clicker in the game. Like, this guy is incredibly powerful, and I don't know, I don't think Juggernaut has the strength to deal with the amount of physical damage that's going to be outpouring from ProDotA. They pick up the Treant Protector, I imagine, to both mitigate the damage that these guys can do, as well as to stop their kind of skirmish pushing. I mean, Beastmaster, he's a decent pusher in his own respect, but Dazzle and Venge, not so much. So if any pushes fail because of the fact that they only have one major pusher, the Treant Protector can easily go and heal that tower back up. So as far as kills go, yeah, the Treant helps by keeping his allies alive, but the tower game should be favored in towards Arcade Esports just because these little skirmishes will start to stack up on ProDotA. Meanwhile, the same cannot be true for Arcade.
I like also that Treant gives them pretty strong lanes too. Like, if they decide to run it as a straight tri-lane bottom or even an aggressive tri-lane, as the DK will be picked. This is just push from ProDotA. But the Treant with his level 1 Leech Seed, as PPD has shown in the past, is still a pretty ridiculous spell. Combined with the Bane and the Juggernaut, that's just an easy kill in any lane, especially if it's going to be the Beastmaster in the offlane solo.
I'm kind of worried about Arcade's lineup so far, though. How are they going to kill ProDotA? Juggernaut, I mean, he's all right damage-wise, but I don't think he's got what it takes to bring down a Beastmaster and a Dragon Knight together, especially when they're both hitting him for a lot of damage, and both of them have very nice stuns, one of which goes through the Blade Fury, or if he has to buy a BKB. Same thing for the Queen of Pain. She might blink in, try to go for the Sonic Wave there, but if she gets immediately stunned by the range of the Primal Roar or the Dragon Tail and the Dragon Form, then you're very dead. So I don't know if they've got enough damage to deal with ProDotA.
Oh, Lord. All right.
Oh, boy.
This is... I have a love-hate relationship with Phoenix, I think.
You have a love-hate relationship with a lot of things.
I mean, that's Dota 2, isn't it? But Phoenix is really frustrating because the early to mid-game teamfight potential once you get your ultimate is really good, but getting there is so freaking tough. It's like you have such low armor in lane that I think probably the best way to build early game is get like 2 rings of protection and some regen, but even then you just get zoned out so easily because your HP pool sucks.
Good. Well, one ring of protection can build into the Tranquil boost, the other can build into a Bassie.
Yeah, I say just keep the second ring of protection and then sell it later. Get an urn first. It's kind of useless to get a
mech. Well, you can disassemble the Bassie and buy the urn with the Sage's Mask. See?
True.
Boom. Disruptor, by the way. Sorry to destroy your train of thought right there, but...
No, this is the thing. Like, this tri-lane is really good at dealing with Phoenix. It's Disruptor. If you time the glimpse correctly, you can just send the Phoenix back once she dives away. There's good stun from the Venge. There's a burst heal from the Dazzle, and he does good right-click damage from range. So like, every single hero in this tri lane is really good at dealing with Phoenix. And I would say the same of Arcade's lineup a little bit. Like, they can deal with the Beastmaster very well. They can zone him out. But Beastmaster has the benefit of, like, being able to assist in pushes. Even if he's a little bit under level, he can stack ancient camps for himself, and there's that additional camp in the off lane now for each side that he can stack. Although the dire side camp next to the ancients is a lot harder to stack. I mean, he can catch up and he can help his team in different ways, whereas the Phoenix, if she's under leveled, she's just food for the enemy team.
Yeah, the I have one big issue with Phoenix in this game, and that's the egg will die to a lot of right clicks coming in. Well, guess what ProDotA have no shortage of? Especially with the Beastmaster. This is going to be a game where the Phoenix is not going to be able to just dive in and let loose with the Supernova. She's got to be incredibly careful, play it almost like a Tidehunter or a Magnus that gets pretty far behind will have to play, and just wait for them to be all occupied, have some sort of opening, or just supernova in the trees or something like that. I don't know exactly how he's going to have to play this, but the general point is that he is going to have a very tough time being able to, one, survive in lane, as you've been saying, but two, even get a full duration supernova off in the middle of a team fight. So perhaps if they supernova and then drop a... oh, God, what's the Trion's ultimate called? No! Overgrowth, thank you.
Overgrowth.
And then drop the Overgrowth, keep him from all diving in, maybe you've got a chance at getting the big team fight off. But then after all that magical damage is through, how do you follow up from that even further? Yeah, you've got the Juggernaut, but if he gets chain stunned down, he's going to die in no time at all. And then, boom, you've got the powwow of the Dragon Knight, the Beastmaster, and the Vengeful Spirit all whacking out your face, and... you're probably going to die in a couple of right clicks.
Yeah, they have to overlay their spells in a very specific way, and they don't necessarily have very good initiation. They have the Phoenix who can dive in, but they have an instant silence if the Disruptor's on its toes. And I think ProDotA just have better team fight in general, but we'll see. It all comes down to execution. You can theorycraft all you want, but in the end, it does come down to execution, as it looks like ProDotA are going to execute immediately and go for a smoke into the enemy jungle.
Yep, speaking of ProDotA, and I apologize because their names aren't actually in-game right now. We've got Sunlight on the Dragon Knight with Vanskor playing the Dazzle. Jackal's going to be on the Vengeful Spirit. Metpum is on the Disruptor, and I believe that's Tron playing the Beastmaster, as it looks like. Anime Boy, he's going to walk right into the Roach Pit. Look at the damage. He just dies immediately. That is a first blood they're going to be talking about in the history books right there, as ProDotA, you said they are going to execute. Well, they executed all right.
Yeah, that's off with his head right there. As Sunlight now is going to have... he even took his Dragon Tail first, just in case. Yep. Didn't end up needing it. It will make him a little bit weaker in the lane, but it does mean that he secures a Bounty Rune for himself. He gets a little bit of XP because there were all five heroes there for the first blood, so he's gonna have a very fast bottle.
And they're off.
Although this is a classic matchup between the Quap and the Dragonite, because like this is old school. It used to be that if you ever played against a Quap and you picked a Dragonite, you would essentially just do this. You would bottle crow and just spam out your breathe fire to get last hits, and essentially just say, as soon as the Quap leaves to gank, I'm going to start hitting your tower, take an objective that way, and that's how I'm going to get my stuff.
Yep. And this babysitting is going to be very important right now for Arcade, because if Sunlight gets anywhere close to get hit by the Shadow Strike and then the Leech Seed, he could be dead in no time at all. So they've got to have the Disruptor close by. In fact, they're going to go for that right now. However, he is a little bit closer to his tower. Where is the courier getting sniped? Oh, Vanskor!
Jeez. What a player.
What a play. That's really good for ProDotA, actually. Did that have the bottle on it?
It didn't have
no.
the bottle. It was Helix 400 gold moves. Worth, so it was a salve.
Yeah.
This is worrying. The early game is going about as poorly as it possibly could for Arcade in a game that I think is going to be decided by the very early stages of the game.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, if this Juggernaut can farm really well, and I'm talking, like, I don't know. Farming mechanisms on the Juggernaut are few and far between, but sometimes it used to be a Mask of Madness, which would give you the attack speed and the movement speed to quickly move between camps. Then now, I think it's become more of a Battle Fury Blink sort of style that you play. But whatever the case, I mean, either Battle Fury Blink or Sanji Nyasha, Mask of Madness, or something like that. But whichever style you want to play, you have to get it fast, and you have to get a lot of gold following it, or you're just going to fall behind. In fact, actually, looks like Tron is going to trade hits with Isengard. Though, I'm not quite sure if either one will die to this. I think Tron's going to be very careful not to give himself up to Anime Boy's attempt at killing him. Speaking of Anime Boy, I don't know any of these guys' actual names. This is really getting on my nerves.
It's okay. We can just say if Arcade win, Anime Boy is the best new carry of the year of 2016. I don't know. I think maybe this game he should consider going like Drum SNY might be okay, in my opinion. That's a personal favorite build of mine for just early game pressure. Because he will have a hard time surviving in this game, and he's possibly going to end up, you know, getting kited a little bit hard by some of these spells, especially the Beastmaster Boar. The Beastmaster Boar is one of the most annoying spells in the game. You can summon two of them at once. They both slow. It stacks, I think.
Does it stack? I didn't think it stacked, but they do a lot of damage.
Yeah. I mean, the attack slow is so freaking annoying.
Oh, yeah. No, this hero is one of my favorite offlaners, and I see people a lot go for the Wild Axis build, and even though, it's pretty strong, I'm more of a favor of leveling up the Inner Beast, mostly because you hit so hard, so fast, and they can't run away from you, so you get easy kills earlier on in the game. But right now, it is going to help him stack up if he needs it. I know you can stack easily the Dire Side offlane camp with the Wild Axes because you need to cut down those trees to actually be able to stack them from the offlane. But you can also, I think if the trees are cut down, you can actually pull this lane too, which is fantastic. But
it's difficult, but I think you can do it. I know Coddle Guy definitely made some videos about it.
Yeah, well, the tower aggroes to it when they pull, so maybe. I don't know. I've yet to see it tried, but hold on. Tron is going to be in a lot of trouble here. He gets nightmared. Even though he gets taken off by the boar, in comes the Blade Fury, and Anime Boy, well, he'll grab a kill. We talked about his need to get gold fast. That is going to be how he's going to do it. If they can continue finding either kills like that or let that secure a free lane for him to get near perfect CS, which he hasn't gotten just yet, or he won't ever get from this point on, but still he's at a very decent score with 18 last hits and 16 denies. This is a very good play for him. Meanwhile, the Beastmaster's been all but zoned out, sitting at level 2, almost level 3, and only 3 CS to his name, two of them being last hits.
Yeah, the benefit of the aggressive lane in the mid is that it forces the Dazzle to come mid and assist the Dragonite more, and it means that the Phoenix gets a lot more out of the lane. He's about to hit level 4 pretty much, as there will be a pause. So the Phoenix is doing slightly better than the Beastmaster. He hasn't died. He's got some good pulls off to that camp on the that's close to the Radiant offlane, and he's looking to maybe secure a rune for his team. He does have a dive and level 2 fire spirit if he feels like it. He could probably, if Quap rotates, they could kill this Dazzle actually, or at least force him to use Grave. He doesn't have Grave skilled yet, but he's like, they can still force him to use it and go back to lane, which it's still a favorable outcome because then it means that he's not in lane assisting anybody else. Maybe it means they get a kill elsewhere. Just takes the pressure off their lanes. Yeah, they can kill here.
Yeah, this is trouble, actually. If he runs to the south, he could be dead. Though, it's going to be Madco's Bad dropping out the Shadow Strike. Though, actually, he turns around, stops the chase. It looks like it's because Metpum is in the back lines, giving them a little bit of a run for their money. I think they got spooked a little bit, thinking that there might be some extra men behind the lines, but it was really just the two supports, and because of that, they completely stopped the aggression. And Vanskor, well, he's quite all right, not having to skill up anything just yet. Actually puts 2 points into Shadow Wave, holding on to that last point, whether he needs the Poison Strike for a gank or the Shallow Grave to protect against one. Whatever ends up being the most necessary outcome for him. A Sunlight comes in with an Invis rune, not going to make an attempt on anyone's life because, well, it's a Queen of Pain. How do you really kill that? Meanwhile, Tron could be in a lot of trouble here if Isengard drops down the Nightmare, but it looks like he's going to hold on that for now because the boar can take it off him. It really is not useful to do it when your carry is so far away.
Yeah, and Sunlight did pick up that Invis rune, but either, like, there wasn't any vision for the Radiant side there. It was just good game sense from them. He rotated into the Radiant jungle, didn't get anything out of it. Wasted a little bit of time, missed a few CS in mid, and this Quap is just dominating him at 30 CS right now to the 16 of the Dragonite.
I mean, this is pretty standard, I think, for any sort of melee. I mean, DK is no exception, but any melee against a Queen of Pain is going to struggle a lot versus that. And I think it also comes down to the fact that the Treant was constantly ganking or at least babysitting in the early parts of the game. And even now, when he's not there, if Sunlight even tries to get a little aggressive, and comes the Living Armor, and Mad because Bad is not going to die to it. In fact, it could put Sunlight in a very compromising position. So actually, a glimpse back on the top. Dance, he's going to get, not going to get stunned, actually. Okay, the Magic Missile does come out, but we talked about it being a slow-moving projectile. That'll stun him way far away as the Icarus dive is on its apex, and looks like he will be just fine. The Living Armor getting him back up pretty decently good on his HP, though. It looks like Vanskor could be in a bit of trouble. Sunlight's there. The Sonic Wave comes through. They want Vanskor. He will have to Shallow Grave and goes ahead for the TP. But that means that Sunlight is going to grab the Regeneration Rune. And even though that Grave gets forced, I think that is a worthwhile trade for the DK to get that, especially since the Sonic Wave was committed. Did my co-caster drop? He may have dropped, so I will continue moving forward here as Tron could be in a bit of trouble. They don't have a Nightmare, at least not yet. Oh, man, that was way too close for comfort. But they will eventually get out with that TP, and three committed, though no real spells, no cooldowns dropped. Still is a little bit of trouble for him as he's trying to find as much experience as possible. Still level 3, almost 4, and they could potentially dive him under tower here. In fact, looks like they will. The ping comes out, but they're not able to grab the Leech Seed just yet. In fact, Tron's going to summon a board and try to keep the movement slow onto Champagne as he'll make his move forward. No real damage coming out on this tower just yet. These guys don't hit all that hard. The healing salve out onto Anime Boy as the bird. Oh, they see the bird and they'll brain sap it. Not that a bird has much brain to begin with, but it's good HP and it gets rid of the vision. Yes, there we go. Are we connected? Are you back?
Hello? Can you hear me?
What happened, dude?
I don't know.
You all left me alone.
No, my mic isn't working in Dota TV either for some reason. I think something's wrong with it or just Dota.
I don't think Dota TV matters because it's not ticketed, but I'm going to make sure. I'm going to turn on open mic anyway because you reminded me that I didn't have it up, but...
Woo! Another pause.
All right, looks like I am being called by the admins to change my map, so I'm going to switch to the pause screen here and go ahead and change my settings here.
What map?
I had it set to the desert terrain. I like the desert terrain. Come on.
Actually, I think Pimmuckle was saying that it makes it easier to see certain things when you have the desert terrain on, but
whatever.
I see the point.
If the admin wants the default, I'll set it to the default.
God, get yourself together, man. Either way, that was, I was saying, I think, as my mic cut out, the trade of a Grave and a TP for a cooldown on the, Sonic Wave, I'll take any day of the week. Is Metpum gonna be in danger here?
Well, we'll see when we come back into this game, because,
they do bring down the Disruptor.
Did they?
Good kill. Yes, Queen of Pain collects it with that scream. And
see what happens when you want to change the desert terrain?
It's punishment. It's okay. This Quap is still doing really well. It's unfortunate that her first Sonic Wave usage didn't collect a kill, but you have to take what you can get. Looks like this Juggernaut wants to push this lane out. How do you feel about the skill build of the Juggernaut? I like the... of course, you max Blade Fury. There's no world that you don't after 6.83. Where it used to be like a 1-1-1 or like max blade dance, but Do you feel like maxing Healing Ward or maxing the crit's a better option here?
To be perfectly honest, it really depends. My favorite Juggernaut build, which you can't always get away with, is putting one value point in both the crit and the Healing Ward and then just max and getting stats. Honestly, I know that's a very old-style build, but it ends up becoming one of the ways that you can farm a lot quicker. Kind of like how an anti-mage... Whoa, that's different. Okay, I'm on the regular terrain now. That was a jump. But it becomes like an anti-mage, how you level up stats. It allows you to just switch seamlessly between the jungle and the lane, but if you were to go for either the Healing Ward or the crit, I would say if you're being harassed, get 2 points in the Healing Ward, and that should be enough for you. Maxing it out typically is not quite necessary, whereas the crit allows you to become an ultra killer. Oh, in the top lane, yep, it's going to be blinking from Madco's bat. I think he hit all three with that Sonic Wave, but they can't cancel Jackal's TP. No. That's right. Omni Slash doesn't do that anymore, so they will not get anything for the Sonic Wave and the Omni Slash committed. And of course, they kind of wish they had Overgrowth, but they didn't quite have it yet. That is still a level 4 Treant. So things going pretty wrong for Arcade there. They still have 2 kills to the 1 of ProDotA, but as far as ganks like that go, you're wasting a lot of time and a lot of effort for literally nothing.
And that's the strength of the Vengeful Spirit. Any other, like, pretty much any other carry, that'd probably be a kill, but she's got 4k net worth, she has a Ring of Akilla, Treads, and Helm of Iron Will. She has almost 1,200 HP and 16 armor. She's very tough to kill.
Yep, an anime boy getting hit by the poison stun here. Looks like they won't be able to get the kill, but they get a lot of damage on him in the meantime. Actually, no. Can Jackal find the Nether Swap? He's going for it. Remember, you go through BKB, so even with the Blade Fury, they cannot stop it. However, Anime Boy is moving a little bit too quick. In comes the Breathe Fire, but that's still not enough to kill him. And now they'll pop out the Leech Seed on the Sunlight to make sure he cannot get that second Breathe Fire off. However, the Shank from Jackal, or sorry, the Flank, though it could be a Shank, whatever you want to call it, Anime Boy, he's feeling like he's in a lot of trouble. They can't stop it, but they do have the Breathe Fire. The last one through the trees to get the kill, and of course the vision from the creeps allowing them to see exactly where he was. So a lot of effort committed to bring him down, but they still do it to even up the kill score. The great equalizer right there, and the three Stooges will make their way to the mid lane to try to find something else. However, it looks like they will walk upon no one as they just go for some shallow pushing.
It does create a little bit of space for this Beastmaster to catch up. He's still behind the Phoenix in terms of net worth, but he's now reached level 7. The Phoenix still at level 5, so... I'll take being a little bit ahead in levels in terms of net worth. Is Metboom going to be brought down on the Disruptor by that rotation from the Phoenix and the Quap? So Phoenix now hits level 6. It looks like he's saving up gold for Midas for going the urn entirely, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, the Midas will allow him to get that level 16 out really quickly. I don't know if he wants the urn because it looks like a very low kill count game.
Yeah,
so, I mean, we've had 5 kills in 12 minutes. Even though the urn can be useful for games like this, you really want to try to avoid getting items that aren't going to make that big of an impact. So you drop, what is it, like 800 or so gold for the urn?
875, I believe.
875, there we go. Gold for the urn. And then, well, what
Smoke
after that? You don't do anything
jungle.
With it.
You're going to find the Bane here.
Yep, they will go ahead with a Nether Swap. That is a, what is that, level 2? No, it's a level 1. That was a big range for a level 1. But they still get it off, and that is going to be a kill onto Isengard. But Sunlight, he doesn't want to let this one go. Doesn't want to let this tower go now as he comes in and goes for the push. Champagne is in the trees, but they don't see him just yet. He's within the Nature's Guise. So even though they had the bird right on top of him, they still don't have any idea he's there. Maybe an inkling, but nowhere near the positioning. Meanwhile, the TP's coming towards the mid, but no one will remain within reach for ProDotA to continue this momentum.
Still, they defend their tier 1 mid, they do lose the tier 1 top eventually, or they lost it in the last push, and this Dragonite has now purchased for himself a full Blink Dagger, so they have a little bit of initiation. I think that was the main issue I saw with their lineup. It's tough to say who initiates. But Sunlight has solved that question by purchasing a very early Blink Dagger. He's going to let the Beastmaster just go for his Necronomicon.
I agree with this one.
It looks like they're
going to
smoke again.
Oh,
Oh, okay. Yep. The Disruptor has one, but they are deciding against it for now.
Yeah, I think that if they want to smoke, they'd have to do it with Tron, just because of the amount of control he's able to give if things go sour quickly. Like, Tron will be able to cast a Primal Roar, maybe have the Boar slow on the main stunner of Arcade, and then they just disengage from there. If they don't have that extra backup, then say the three folks gank, and then a multiple TPs come in and things go sour, they really have no way to disengage because they're all pretty damn slow. So they won't actually smoke up for a gank. They will instead go after the Roshan. They've got the Medallion of Courage, but no real other minus armor, at least not close to them. It looks like Jackal's far away, so they're going to disengage off the Roshan for now. Perhaps wait until Jackal's with them to go for it next, as it looks like a small push coming. Actually, there's a smoke from Arcade. They smoke under a ward? No, it seems like ProDotA, though, have every idea that this is happening. The Invis rune on Sunlight looking to disengage the smoke, and it will end up being useful as he blinks up to the high ground. On to Dance. They'll swap back Isengard, but the Overgrowth not really being that useful. The Nightmare out on the Sunlight will end now, as all the ultimates now are being destroyed, especially the Asala Supernova, and then Champagne will go down mad cause bad. Is going to be pretty mad because he went down bad. And Roshan will be the next target for ProDotA. A clean and easy four kills. Arcade getting annihilated there by the rune spot. And it looks like the only one not there, Anime Boy. Well, he's only got a Yasha, so if he was there, I'm pretty sure that would not have worked out very well in their favor.
That was... honestly, that fight was anything but clean. It was pretty sloppy. The Disruptor missed his ultimate. Dragonite blinked in and then got a stun off, and then the Juggernaut actually was there. He did react. Like
I saw the Omni Slash, but he left
really quick.
He used his
Omni Slash, but the Bane used Nightmare on him and then completely negated it. So, bit of a sloppy team fight from Arcade. The Disruptor ultimate did miss, but ultimately it didn't mean anything. They were able to bring down the Phoenix during the ultimate, so... they will have to execute a little bit better in the future if they want to win this game. They are losing a little bit in net worth. It's a little over 3,000 gold for the Dire here.
Yeah, the one issue, I think we saw a little bit of that in the last fight too, was that Arcade, they definitely had some lack of coordination there, but also killing ProDotA still is one heavy task for them, that they're having a lot of trouble between the heals from Vanskor as well as the innate tankiness from Sunlight. Oh, actually, he's going to move forward, looking for a stun, gets onto Isengard. They're not able to stop any other TPs. Actually, now Isengard will go for it. Do they have any way to stop? No! As Metpum, he had already used his Glimp. It doesn't matter, he was Nightmared anyway. And that will be a free disengage for Arcade. A little bit cleaner from them right there, but still goes to the point. Yeah, they can escape, but can they actually take a fight and do any real lasting damage to ProDotA's lineup?
This is something that I don't think we pointed out during the draft. It's just that neither team really has a whole lot of stun. With the Venge not there, like, she's the main source of lockdown unless the Beastmaster wants to use his Roar, but he wasn't in range to do it there anyway. Both teams can use the old time-honored strat of teleporting away.
I mean, if it works, it works, right? It didn't seem like ProDotA was ready for it. The one stun that they got off was on a hero that had not used a TP yet. So, hold on, the Primal Roar comes in, but that's after he casts the Icarus Dive. So even if he didn't die during that stun, he'd have no way to disengage off that fight. And of course, I think they had the magic missile to follow up too, so there was no way he was living through that one. A quick and easy pickoff for ProDotA will lead into a tower. And I think I mentioned how they didn't have much push aside from the Beastmaster. Well, now that he's there with Necronomicon's two boars, and the rest of the lineup from ProDotA are getting quite a bit of damage, they've got plenty of ways.
Now.
What?
They push very fast now.
Yeah.
They've reached their peak. They could go high ground potentially, but they will go back to defend their tier 1. They don't want to make any trades happen during this period where they're ahead. As it looks like there will be TPs away from the Bane at least. Sunlight, not going to stun.
Yeah, they will move forward for Anime Boy. It looks like they will come out with the Dragon Tail. In comes the Magic Missile. They've got lots of damage. Can he get out of it? No, he can't. He didn't even cast his TP.
Although he knew he was dead there.
It could have been close after the Magic Missile, but... I don't know, either way, in the bottom or in the top lane, rather. It looks like Madoka's Bat is going to bring down Tron, staying a little late. Same will be Metpump, as he is going to get brought down. The Sunray coming through, but ultimately it is Isengard to bring down the Disruptor. So ProDotA maybe staying in a little bit too long, overstaying their welcome on the top lane, but they also lose a tier 1 bottom. So I don't think that TP out was too useful. In fact, ProDotA may have been able to just continue straight pushing into the tier 3. Perhaps it was a little miscommunication there, like half the team wanted to do it, half the team didn't. And that's a recipe for a disaster when everyone's not on the same page.
It was, I mean, because Arcade are behind, any trade they can get is going to be favorable, but they are slowly collecting more gold on this Phoenix with his Midas. He's getting a little bit more leveled. He's going to hit level 11 fairly soon. He needs to clear up this wave, and he will hit 10, I believe. Mm-hmm. So he's very close to his next level of Supernova. They do have the Overgrowth up on Champagne. He's going looking for something, but not going to get a whole lot. I like the decision-making from Arcade a lot. They saw that the Phoenix died on top, and they correctly assessed, okay, we're going to lose two towers. There's not much we can do about it. We're going to rotate all four bottom, force PD into making a decision that could potentially unfavor them, or potentially not favor them, and it did end up working out, where they took a tower, got two kills. They did lose the Juggernaut, but he has completed his Manta style now. His item progression isn't going to be great this game, but he's still leading in net worth for his team.
Jackal's also completed a Manta style, and the smoke up from ProDotA will head towards the mid lane. They're not going to find anyone, though. The only person close by is Champagne, who was underneath the Tier 2 tower in his Nature's Guise. So even though they don't find anyone, they still will just go straight in for this Tier 2 tower. Now, I think at this point, they have no real choice but to trade Tier 2. It's a big thing. Actually, no, this top Tier 2 isn't taking any damage at all. There's no trade happening in a million years, and now they'll push their way up to the high ground. Sunlight going to start laying down some hurt on that Tier 3. Jackal's there as well. Lots of damage, lots of attack speed. They're making short work of this tower. They're just going to go straight after the Rex. It doesn't seem like Arcade are really in a position to stop this. Madoka's Bad gets swapped right underneath everyone from ProDotA. They immediately follow up with a stun. And that is going to be a Queen of Pain down without buyback. In comes the Overgrowth, but Jackal's going to pop the Mantis style to get out of it. Oh, the Fiend's Grip will stop him. The Soul Up and Over will get make short work of, and two will die inside the Static Storm as Isengard will go down 21 minutes, and the game is over. GG is called. What a dominating performance from ProDotA.
That's just... they knew exactly what the strength of their lineup were going to be. They played to it. They recognized... all right, it's 20 minutes. We may have just lost the Aegis on our Vengeful Spirit, but there is honestly nothing that Arcade can do to stop us. So very, very good strategic decision-making from them. It looks like Arcade will have to go back to the drawing board. Seems like their Champagne Supernova strat didn't work out.
It did not work out. So yeah, they definitely have to take some time, think about this game. Speaking of, game number two will be coming up very shortly, guys. I'm Chicago Ted. Joining me is Das Turbo. And remember, follow the channel. There is going to be a Zeus giveaway after the second series of the day. So keep an eye on the prize for that one. In the meantime, guys, we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back with the second game.